Welcome back, everybody, here to the Joinetta MLG Pro League. I'm Tubby One, your host for the English live stream, and we are going into game number two of our two-game series between MVP Phoenix as well as Invasion Esports. The draft is already underway. Let's get straight into it. My co-caster for the Southeast Asian matches today, Basecap.
Sup?
Hey, Tubby.
What's happening?
What's chilling? What's cracking like it?
This is a first pick Earthshaker. I don't know. It's an Earthshaker.
10 seconds remaining.
You're getting an Earthshaker over a Vengeful Spirit, over a Lion, and over every other possible core you probably want, like a Sniper, for example.
Radiant team pick.
Or a Chen, or an Enigma, one of which MVP might actually be able to get here, which would be pretty interesting.
I'd prefer to see MVP Phoenix now go for Killers. You've got a Sniper and a Clockwork. Remember what we talked about during the last game. Clockwork is the best counter up against Sniper right now because it's the perfect way of reducing the distance. The second one was the Storm Spirit, which is now selected. But the Clockwork for me is the best one because he comes in with the Battery Assault and puts Sniper into a set of cogs. But more importantly, he forces Sniper to buy a 4-star for the very beginning. You can't just go into this quick Mask of Madness as well as Yasha thing unless your support heroes are always behind you with a 4-star or some level of protection. So this is kind of why I like the fact that MVP Phoenix pick up the perfect counter with the core hero they're also searching for. But with the Storm Spirit selection, if MVP Phoenix gets something like Skywrath Mage that functions with the Clockwork, Mystic Flare into the middle of the cogs, but more importantly the seal against the Storm Spirit, then I'm sensing a large amount of trouble for Invasion Esports getting any form of combo or pick against this MVP Phoenix lineup. I know I'm calling out a hell of a lot when we've only had two pickups, but still, this is the way I could see this going down in the second pick phase.
Yeah, I think you're right that the Skywrath Mage would work really well. There's still tons of support options as well for MVP. There's a Silencer, which we don't see a heck of a lot, but is still already looking pretty decent against Earthshaker and Storm. There's even potentially Rubick this game, depending on how they run other lanes and whether or not he's going to be able to get a 4 position. But an Instant Lift and already a potential Fissure Steal are both pretty tasty so far. And Invasion do end up banning out the Chen. I think it's worth doing just because Chen's timing lines up so nicely with Clockwork. We've seen games where Chen and Clockwork just working together. Chen picks up his mech. He's got his mech. He's got his Brown Boots. Clock's already level 7, level 8. And that team is just ready to 5-man. And I think that's a really dangerous thing to have happen, especially when you're playing a hero like Storm, where you want to be getting pickoffs, you want to be split farming. If a team turns up at your base as a group of 5, it can be a little bit difficult to get in there and get things done. But yeah, you called it, Tubby. There's the Skywrath Mage.
I got a still spathful.
A little pat on the head.
Yeah, I'm a good boy. I'm a good boy.
MVP.
Now they're just going to fire the other combinations with it. So you want to have a stunning combo that can also work with the Skywrath so you can roam. I'm actually down with your selection of the Enigma. I really feel in this game that MVP Phoenix can play basically the farm card and win this in late game. So they get something like an Enigma and then a very stable, safe laner. Alright. There's enough of those.
10 seconds remaining.
Yeah, there's plenty. I wonder. So the Enigma is pretty good at spacing out the fights. You know, Midnight Pulse eats up a lot of room, and then also Enigma can just tank up a little bit and threaten the Black Hole, and that can make it easier for the Sniper. I mean, that's what we saw, I think, excellently done by MVP in the previous game, and in particular by Ace of Spades, just always being there with the Fissure every single time, locking people out, creating space for the Sniper, letting him do his job. And the Clockwork can, to an extent, do that this game, but it is a little bit different, and there's a whole spectrum here of you could go super, super defensive and look for, you know, a Shadow Demon or something like that, or you could you can go for something more like the Enigma or a Sand King, a little bit more proactive.
Actually, I'm loving the Sand King. I'm loving the Sand King now that you say that. Combining it with the Faceless Void, like, you can get the Epicenter into the middle of that, then you got Mystic Flare to combine with him as well. Your team fight is looking amazing. When the Faceless Void, like, his buffer is all you really need. You don't need the Enigma anymore. because you just use the Chronosphere, and that's going to keep everyone away from the sniper. Remaining. This is
5 seconds remaining.
This is such a smart void pick as well. This is such a smart void pick, I think.
Reserve time.
Well, it's like, what's Invasion going to do to even stop him from farming? You run this as a safe lane Void. You could even get away with running him as an off lane, because you're up against a Fissure, which Void has no problem with. He time walks over it. And the Paralyzing Cask, he can time walk away. The flight time is so damn slow for a Witch Doctor that I think the Void can actually be played... because you get the Clockwork. I take it back.
Yeah.
I'm nuts. I am completely nuts. I was right for the Skywrath, and I can be bonkers for this one.
Yeah, but the Void pick synergizes really well, like you said, with the Skywrath Mage. Sniper has no problems whatsoever being able to dish out damage from any angle on the Chronosphere, so you're not going to be worried about that. It's more lockdown for the Storm Spirit, and it's also that stable safe lane movie you were talking about that they were looking for.
MVP Phoenix.
Okay, Invasion. This is something a little bit different. They end up going for the Phoenix, so... something to potentially help keep the Faceless Void slow down, put some pressure on the offlane. But they are picking Phoenix into Skywrath Mage, which personally doesn't bode well with me.
Yeah, it kind of doesn't go well with me either, because the early stages could go horribly, horribly wrong. You get a Skywrath Mage that's already going to be prioritizing Ancient Seal, because he's looking for long duration hold time over on the Storm Spirit.
Ten seconds remaining.
In the team fights that'll be coming up, Sniper's going to take out your egg in a matter of no time. Because he's not going to be sitting inside the effect of the Nova with 4 points up and take aim. Reserve and if he does build a Mask of Madness, the Phoenix is toast. Correct me if I'm wrong, but Icarus Dive doesn't disjoint Assassination, right?
No, it shouldn't. It doesn't really disjoint a heck of a lot. I've seen people get Magic Missiled in the middle of it, so...
Okay,
I think. Yeah, maybe don't quote me on that one. But
We can keep our eyes open for it. As far as my knowledge goes, that's why I just wanted to double check. It doesn't disjoint it.
I would say that it doesn't. So
yeah, which basically means the Phoenix. The only thing you'd hope for is the range would disjoint.
10 seconds.
But if the assassination hit's already gone off, then Icarus Dive isn't going to save you, because the bullet will fly and follow. So MVP Phoenix, their final selection. It looks like ADTR thought they were going to go for the Enigma. But we've already said, like, MVP Phoenix, they've got so many options that can go with that Skywrath Mage. I think we both like the SK selection, because it gives them roaming ganking potential up against heroes like the Storm Spirit. And that's exactly what they go for.
There we go!
I pat you on the back, you pat me on the back, everyone gets a pat on the back!
We're on the ball tonight, Toby, we are on the ball.
See? People who ever judge our analytical abilities continue to judge them because they're not that great. All right. Invasion. Number one core now that they have to have that can battle up against someone like a Faceless Void, can deal with the burst damage of an SK Skywrath. Because do keep in mind that when they both hit level 6 and get a Blink Dagger on the SK, you get the Blink to borrow into Epi with the Mystic Flare coming down too. There's no hero on Invasion Esports currently which would be able to tank that one up. The Spectre would have come close if you got a good start. Would have come very close if you got a good start. But who else have you got?
I thought they might pick Medusa. I thought they might pick Medusa.
Medusa's honestly not enough. I don't even think Medusa is enough here. And I got a horrible feeling too that Medusa's just going to die. Okay, he's going to die faster. Because my problem with the Medusa is the fact that I don't think she'll ever get in close and can get too easily controlled. Like, you just lock her in, the Mystic Flare will burn through most of her shield, and if you just commit both Epicenter as well as Mystic Flare, you're going to kill the Medusa.
Yeah, I don't think it would have been an amazing pick, but the Phoenix pick kind of led me down that road of thinking, oh, okay, they can protect the egg. They've shown over the course of the last few games that they've played that they do seem to prefer duo core kind of, you know, grittier lineups overall. But yeah, I totally agree that Medusa still would have gotten blown up.
I think any hero they would have selected right now is running the risk of just getting blown up. So
yeah.
Prepare for battle.
Ah, looks like we might be having our ping issues again. Hello, 434 ping. There's nothing wrong with the internet line. The internet line's 100% okay. It's just our connection into Southeast Asia. But I'll pray we're going to be fine. I've cast on higher pings. I've cast China. Doesn't get any higher than China. WTF, yeah. Man, he's moving quickly. He's a little bit more... Yeah, it looks like he's scared. He waited for the rest of his team to arrive. So, are they going to actually loop around and find an opening? This could be a big one. In fact, that's a really big one here. QO. I don't think Ace can really help him out. Paralyzing cards, because it's not going to bounce, because Ace kept his distance here. And now it's Invasion. You do not want to be fighting this one. If they try to follow that up, they're too close towards the tower. To they can go up against Burrow Strike, and even if at level 1, it's still enough control. And then a whole bunch of shrapnels to fly their way. So they still want to engage. Like, another level 1 fight for Invasion isn't too bad, but... Alright, they're backing up. They're backing the hell up. They got their two sets of wards down, or three wards back down. And that's going to stop SK from at least stacking up those picket camps.
Yeah, I think it's smart from Invasion to do this, especially seeing the Skyrat Sand King and knowing that often Sand King's going to pick up boots first, so it's pretty unlikely that they're going to have sentries compared to a hero like Chen or Enigma, where you've got lots of extra gold at the start of the game to throw at your teammates and invest in sentries. So they're going to slow him down a little bit, but I think Ace still has a backup plan. He's got his smoke, he's got his boots. If they can get level 3 on the Sand King, say, level 2 on the... Even if they just get level 2 on the Skyrath Mage and they have level 1 on the Sand King, and they might even be able to go and gank mid, so... There's a lot of pressure on Ghost here to just keep tabs on both of the supports and make sure that he's making calls, but... I don't think this ward is going to get dealt with at all, so... I think they're in a pretty good spot for this lane.
I was going to give massive props to March. He made two very simple plays. And the timing of it was perfect. So the Juggernaut was running down the river, straight from mid, to try and reach the 100-100 rune. And all he did was throw the cogs and block up the river. This forced WTF to actually run back up the river, back past the tier 1 tower in the mid, and then through his own jungle. So he completely missed the body block. And then March got into the bottom lane, did the cog block, but he was just a fraction of a second too late clicking it. So we only caught two of the creeps. And he couldn't get them into the trees, which was his plan. But and apart from that, he got to the bottom lane at the right time, and he did a nice little block on the Juggernaut. Small little things, but I thought, you know what? I thought he could win the lanes directly from that.
But well, he almost has. He's about to get level 3, and the Witch Doctor is still going to be level 1 or level 2. So he actually has kill pressure on the Witch Doctor pretty easily with his boot stand. That means that when the Witch Doctor goes to pull, he needs to be very, very careful and position himself defensively. Well, he can't even pull, because the pull is actually blocked, but,
incoming.
Yeah, this is a pretty dicey situation now for FCFC. Looks like he's just going to do a bit of stacking, camp the two-minute rune, finding something to do at least. Needs to be careful.
Just saying hello for the runes. I'm watching this middle lane to see if Storm Spirit can play catch-up, because his bottle has just arrived. So now we can spam a lot more. The QO has been so aggressive up against ADTR, and with a haste rune on the SK, first blood. In fact, Clockwave. What? It's a level 2 rocket from bottom lane to just KS the mid. It's like, hey, SK's gonna have some use here. Now he's gonna actually, he will still be of use. He's got a haste rune. He'll have to dive under the tower and take some damage, but they're pushing as fast as they can to get the creep wave to come under the tower. Beware the Icarus dive, the seal is up, and this is the problem we were talking about before. Look how long they wait as well. They waited the maximum amount of time to make sure the seal would then wear off, and then the SK came in for the Burrow Strike. Patience from MVP.
Yeah, so while they blocked his jungle, but he's still finding a whole bunch of plays, and Ace actually almost already level 3, so... Things looking really good here at the start.
What do you think of the build coming out from the Clockwork? Actually going treads first as opposed to going for something like Arcanes or anything else?
Personally, I'm a fan of the treads, especially if you're good at tread swapping and you can stretch out your mana pool a whole lot. I think that's well worth it. And Sniper may not be going bottle necessarily this game, so he may actually be able to go treads bottle and get a lot of value out of it that way.
I'm not quite sure exactly what Invasion feel they're going to achieve here. because they don't have any damage that can reach March. They can fissure, but unless WTF is right on top of March, he can't get the kill, because March will just cogs and push him back. Looks like Ghost is dead again. His Icarus dive was on cooldown. I don't know if he aggressively dived on nuts.
Yeah, I think so. Oh well.
Yeah, problems. Looks like it's gonna be a bounty rune for the Storm Spirit. That means it's an invis rune coming for the sniper. Or potentially the SK again. But he'll get scouted out by this Radiant Observer. What if he does pick it up? But even if he does, then the Storm Spirit's gonna be living in fear. Because he's still not level 6 yet. He's level 5.5. So the invis rune is picked up. And this Storm Spirit has to back up. Actually, do they see it? No, they don't. The Observer actually doesn't see that far down. So they're gonna Burrow Strike in. Assassination still available here for QO. Nice Fissure with the stun. Follow up Shrapnel. Now the assassination starts. Sandstorm needs to evade. They turn off the assassination because they need more damage. And now QO just assassinate. He'll get the kill over on Extinct. Needs to back up as well while Nuts makes some space. But it's 4-0 in favor of MVP. They're looking very, very solid right now in their lanes and the whole game.
I think they were trying... I feel like Extinct may have pinged the... Did they actually see the rune? Or
no,
did they just
no.
See the
I checked the observer.
Oh, they don't.
It doesn't see far enough down, so they didn't know the Invis was there. They just knew the SK was rotating to mid. But at the same time, you'd still want to be more defensive because you don't have an Observer Ward watching the top river entry into mid. So ADTR is going to have this happen to him again. Let's keep beating him down with the orb attacks. He doesn't have enough mana to ball lightning away. And there's no way he wants to use Sol Ring with QO that hot in his tail. He's got to go back.
For you.
But he can't stay on the front lines here. He has to go back to base. They're going to try to have a crack at bottom lane. Actually, no, they're not. I thought FCFC was using the tree line to try and come in from the side. But then I just realized who the Juggernaut's not level 6. So there's no Omni Slash. It's the only way to get inside the cogs and kill March off.
I'll take your tribute.
Invasion. Okay, so ADTR is gambling. I think he might be gambling a little bit here to go and try and find a kill. There is a haste. So we'll see what he can get there. He really wants to get a kill on the sniper. I mean, Extinct's not only been camping mid to help defend the Storm Spirit and secure his level 6, but I think they'd also like to use this ball lightning now to potentially bring him down. And he needs the lockdown because he's gone for the no vortex build for the little bit of extra burst, little bit of extra farming speed. So needs Extinct there, but good warning from MVP. They've got this mid lane completely covered and they can see the Earthshaker even up on the high ground during nighttime. So
yeah, they can see the fact the SK also came down and gave the Arcane Boots charge over to the Skywrath mate, so under attack. Like even if they did jump, like Minot's had everything he could throw. He kind of had it already because his mana pool is so great on the Skywrath mage. But one person which we haven't really been talking about is the one who's the teamfight man. We've got a Mask of Madness, I'm assuming that's the recipe. That's the recipe coming out right now to the Faceless Void. So he's got a Chrono Mask of Madness level 7.5. He can solo once he's got the Mask of Madness, he can solo the Phoenix as long as he's not affected by the sprites. Just leap in and kill. Wait, what?
Uh-oh.
That was stack farming, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was certainly not intentional, Toby.
Uh-oh. Yeah. So I was thinking maybe he had himself a bad fight and then denied himself off. I didn't see his life points drop like that. And even Extinct is currently dying to neutrals.
The skeletons are really sneaky.
Oh, they got more blame. And WTF got in close enough. He's got Omni Slash, he's gonna let it rip. He'll come underneath the T1 tower and the cogs push him back a little bit. And the tower will still get a couple attacks over on him.
This will come in.
Alright, Void. Show me your magic. He's got support coming up from the Skywrath Mage. With the aggressive Observer Ward planted behind the tower as well, they're gonna have perfect vision of what they're up against on top. QO. I think he kinda knows that his assassination harassment won't work up against the Storm Spirit who's over level 6. Cause the ball lightning dodge is just too easy.
Yeah, it's just reminding him, I think. And doesn't want to waste the mana either. You know, it would suck to use an assassinate, have it be dodged, and then need it to kill a support later on or something like that, but you don't have the mana, so... Pretty heads up from Q, especially given that he hasn't gone for bottle or you know, any kind of... No stick, no burst magic regen or anything like that, so it has to be a little bit conservative with his mana pool. Extinct roamed up to top, but the MVP ward coverage is still just so spot on that they've even seen this rotation. He's just sitting behind the... Hopefully, you know, save the Phoenix if he gets hit by this Chrono, but... I don't know, I guess...
But by doing so, like, all of his other lanes are so heavily exposed. Marge is playing around with the Storm Spirit, watching him by throwing out the rocket and being in hookshot range. While the smoke movement from the SK and the Skywrath Mage, they're gonna head down to bottom. They're looking for a kill over on WTF. QO is slowly chipping away the tower, so they're assuming one of the supports is gonna rotate in towards the mid and away from bot lane. And they were right. The smoke just broke on Nuts. The vision for the Radiant side does not see this, so Nuts ties to the tree line. They see the Witch Doctor with the Clockwork Rocket. And they see what he's trying to do, which is the pull. And that means they know he'll come back up again. But March can't make any kind of aggressive move on that bottom lane while the Observer Ward's watching him. I'm fairly certain he knows that too. Alright, SK's gonna get scouted out. So, the party's over. They walked in range of the Observer Ward watching the bottom rune.
Radiant's middle
but the tier 1 tower still belongs to QO. Storm's got AWOL. He's triggered the haste rune and run up towards the top lane. And they're gonna jump, but you got time walk away from the face of support. You're never gonna get this kill. Not with the mana pool or the Storm Spirit the way it currently is.
Yeah, this is a really bad start for Storm. 0-2, pretty average on net worth. The way that, like, Stumail, for example, makes this Storm build really work is getting the kills without needing to use Electric Vortex and then finding a lot of farm in between with good rune control and having that to keep his mana pool up. But ADTR, that's a couple of unsuccessful times now, and... What? Ace? Okay. Righto. Just pops Epi in the middle of the trees and then walks into some mud golems. Alright.
If you didn't say that, I never would have noticed. But, sorry. Ace Hoop must have something against you, Ace.
Yeah, maybe I shouldn't have mentioned it. Ultimate is mysteriously on cooldown.
I don't know why. No ulti. No ulti, sorry. It's gone. Alright, so... Rando pause. Mm-hmm. We've got the Archer build coming in from the Sniper. He knows what he needs. I'm actually interested to see the Storm Spirit, see how he builds into this game. Like, if Orchid is his poison of choice. Because I'm thinking, who exactly is he going to control? It's not going to be...
BKB so bad this game.
He does, but... Like, if you go the BKB, then you've got no control factor, and... He kind of, like, is your initiator for control until the Earthshaker has a Blink Dagger. Which, by the looks of it, he's not going to be near anytime soon. Sitting at only just over 1,000 net worth 12 minutes into this game, he needs a lot more time to make things happen. And in fact, they're going to lose heroes on top. Skywrath Mage isn't level 6 just yet. If one more of these creeps dies and he's the one in range, he'll have level 6. They brought Extinct as well as FCFC up to the top lane. While on bottom lane, QO is taking another tower. Much as this babysitter. But both have TPs to join the top lane fine if it does erupt. In fact, they're gonna... Right, that's a rocket on mid, try and slow down WTF. It's like no one wants to fight each other. Storm's gonna find the SK, but he's got no reveal. He's got no way to get SK out of the sandstorm. I doubt he's gonna walk in close and start spamming Remnants. Ace is Spyro Strike away. Storm. You can't jump this. Because Sandstorm's back off cooldown already. And now QO, in fact, comes in towards the middle lane. Forcing WTF back, they hold their tier 1 tower. Looks like top lane, they did go for the Chrono combo with the Mystic Flare. Fish is gonna drop on the face of Void, and look how far up this Storm goes. He's chasing down the Skywrath Mage, dragging him back. They've still got more stun to stop that TP out from the face of Void, but his time walks off cooldown plus 5 stick charges. He baits him into the side of the tree lines. Another stun gonna come up, but he's up further, digging into the trees. And Storm's gonna jump after him, but he's also so low on mana. Nuts needs to help him out, throws out a couple of orbs, And the Faceless Void will in fact die in the tree line. Looks like that Sol Ring was able to be enough to get him up. And QO, goodbye, man. You're isolated from your creep wave, which means Omnislash. And he realized his mistake as he walked up. The TP came in, which forced him to run back. And that just opened up for the Omnislash. Two big kills coming in for Invasion. MVP. They're getting caught out where they really shouldn't be.
I think QO kind of forgot that there were enemy heroes on the map after he took the tier 1 and the tier 1, well, the tier 1 mid and the tier 1 bot completely uncontested, so.
I'll take
a
that
bit of a reminder there as he gets omnislashed, but.
Not PvE. The Storm Spirit just sat on top lane. I got to see that epicenter. I didn't see the bad epicenter, I saw the good epicenter. Epicenter in the tree line, Blink Fire strike onto the Storm Spirit and brought him down. Storm was getting a little bit greedy though with his farming. March, he's looking for the opening to just go into Extinct, and he's got it. With the Battery Assault, Extinct can't get any of the stuns off, making it Fire Strikes, and his corpse almost got pushed out of the map by the cogs, and both heroes are TPing out. They got what they wanted, and they get the hell out of Dodge.
WTF, he's eyeing up QO again.
This time though, he doesn't have Omnislash. And with the Mask of Madness turned on, QO could dish out a hell of a lot more damage to WTF than, WTF can do to him. Even with those 3 points up in crit.
This lane, this war behind the tower top from MVP, I think has, like, saved them probably 2 or 3 deaths already. The Storm just keeps going up because he feels like he needs to put pressure on the Void or whoever's farming up there, but just hasn't been able to find a single thing, and
they're about to kill mid. Chronosphere, there's not even a leap in, it's just a quick seal to Mystic Flare, amplify everything you've got, and they caught Juggernaut 2. The assassination was going to come, but looks like got out of range, hookshot in 3 seconds time. But March, there's no point diving into this, they just leave an aggressive ward behind, and they're pinging out and saying, well, while Storm is down, they got no jump in, so Roshan time. And this Phoenix isn't ready to fight, he only just finished his hand of Midas on the top lane.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Everyone's going mid.
It looks like a smoke to try and come out. Yeah, there's smoke over on the Witch Doctor. 4 men smoke. They're gonna be too late. The damage output from MVP Phoenix is just too high. They can kill off Roshan before Invasion will arrive. And there's even a Haste Rune just sitting in the bottom river, which will allow them to chase the Aegis Immortal into the Sniper. Haste Rune picked up by that Sniper, so we can keep the distance as long as the stuns keep coming in. But it's nice for just done into the Dead Ward. So Mantra will drop. There goes Yennora and the Omni Slash! WTF reached him! So the Aegis Immortal will trigger. The Clockwork Cox trapped up the Storm Spirit, but QO is in so much trouble. Dropping the Shrapnel, dropping a secondary one in behind the tower, using the Fog of Fall. The Sprites though, burning him down. Storm Spirit, long jump up! But it's long enough to get the kill while the Sand King in to pick up another one. He's got himself a triple kill here. The Storm Spirit will drop too as the Faceless Boy comes to join in. SK Epicenter. I actually missed that one because I was too busy watching the Juggernaut kill off the Sniper. But did that Epicenter hit all of Invasion in the bottom river, I'm assuming?
No, so as the fight split over that way, Ace was actually up here and he just ran down and got the Earthshaker and the Witch Doctor right there and just blew them both up.
So he came from behind.
Came from behind.
Well, with that, you can kind of say, like, Ace is kind of... Do we want to say almost MVP right now for MVP? He's been in the perfect position. The solo kill on Storm Spear on the top lane. Kind of always been there for the right team fights. And that one, like, if he didn't get what he did then... Like, I'll be saying right now, Invasion will be taking the tier 1 tower in middle lane and establishing a hell of a lot more map control. Not to mention momentum on their other heroes.
Yeah, he totally salvaged that fight. I mean, Earthshaker didn't get a single spell off and he immediately cancelled the Death Ward as well. So that was really big plays from him.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
MVP still have to do something about WTF.
Dire's middle tower.
He's getting bigger.
Fallen.
He is going to go in as well for the mana style. Which is a surprising item choice when you think about it. Like he's just trying to get out of the seal of the Sky Wrath Mage, but you can do the same kind of thing with a BKB. And I doubt he's going directly into Skadi after finishing up the Yasha.
Yeah, no, he's got the Mantis recipe. It's actually, it's a much better farming item on melee heroes than it is on range, just because of the damage difference and the cooldown. You can actually use it to push out waves and get a lot of tower damage. So I think that's the big reason. It's actually almost an additional farming item on top of the Mask of Madness. WTF is kind of aiming to pick up another two big items maybe in the next 10 minutes or 15 minutes.
My concern would be the fact that he won't have that time. Because MVP's already ready to fight. They're going to jump up, leap in, Chrono Spear. That stops the Wish Doctor dead in his tracks. He's going to drop. Extinct can't do anything. In fact, it's going to be a Blink Burrow Strike to take out both the Spores. WTF tried to do something about the SK, and he Omni Sizes onto the SK. Nova will finish, in fact, channeling. So Ghost comes back up to full life with a 2-for-1 trade-off. QO, careful. The Fissure connects on both of them. He tried to assassinate a couple of the times. I think he's looking for the Phoenix connection with Skywrath Mage Orb. They probably would have had the kill there.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
But they actually lost the Urshaga survived, but the Storm Spirit died a hell of a lot further up. Fallen. What was he doing so far away from the rest of his team? Especially fighting before WTF had rotated up from mid.
They saw an opportunity on the sniper and they went for it, but didn't manage to bring him down. And good job by K Phoenix as well, just jumping in and dropping the Chrono, preventing the death ward. Again, invasion supports just get expertly controlled that fight. FZFC gets Chrono, the Earthshaker gets Epicenter, doesn't die, but still prevents him from getting in and hitting an Echo Slam off or getting too much value out of Fissure. The invasion, despite getting pushed back in these last two fights, they're still going to smoke up, still going to continue looking for picks, still going to continue looking for plays, though they do have WTF in the front this time around.
Let's see what they can get from this. With no Chrono up, they're not going to get counter-initiated, but the SK is going to see him coming in, and blink, and blink. And that's all she wrote. Kind of one of those moments where you almost want to do the anti-climax play. Oh, they're coming into the jungle. The smoke is going to be there. Oh, they get... No, he just blinks away. And now it's going to be SK, in fact. Storm Spirit. It's kind of low on mana. So potentially there would have been a blink to Baro Strike, but he would have got too far away from the rest of his team if he tried it. In fact, now they just...
I think he would have gone for it. They just got seen by the ward.
MVP is... Alright, it's like they're chasing ghosts. They move from lane to lane, they search for a player from Invasion. Invasion sees them coming, or feels them coming, and then just backs the hell out. Kind of interesting choice as well, coming in from the Sand King. I was expecting something along the lines of, like, if he's got a real good start, so he potentially could have even gone in for something like a Scythe, which I know is a little crazy to say, but he could have done so. Or a Ghost Scepter to waste the Juggernaut ulti. But instead he goes for a Yule Scepter. I'm wondering if this might also be because he's wanting some quick disable up against the Witch Doctor, so the Faceless Void doesn't have to commit to Chrono to get rid of that Death Ward. Blink. Yule Scepter. Kyoro can't assassinate into that one. Now we can, but not required. The Gank Boys. Very, very efficient.
The Yules gives him a lot of options. It's very similar to the Ghost in being able to waste some of the Omni Slash if it ends up on you. It can dodge the potential stun from the Supernova. Like you said, really good at interrupting the Witch Doctor Death Ward if he doesn't manage to catch him in the initial Burrow Strike. So I think really, really nice pickup here for Ace. And still just making plays this whole game long. 4-1-7. He's got the score to show for it. And he's actually more farmed than two out of the three cores on Invasion right now. So putting in work for sure.
Amazing what happens when you play killer style SK. As opposed to stack five times farm in the jungle SK. Once this BKB is up for Faceless Void, which he's just been trying to flash farm inside the jungle, a little bit more difficult when there's an Observer Ward blocking up one of his camps. He wants BKB up and running. The sniper's building into Ascardi, already having the first ultimate orb. That one. Still a long way off getting it. Looks like Marsh might also be in a little bit of trouble. Okay, I take it back. They don't have a jump. There's no initiation. So he's in no trouble whatsoever. Have we really hit this world again where there's just no jump initiation from invasion, which is capable of achieving anything? Like, Storm Spirit can't do anything until he has the BKB. And he's trying to find it up right now. But until that point, you're not going to find anything. What attack the SK? Or is he just so far away? He used his epicenter again. Q-O is now going to die as the Storm Spirit just jumps in on him. Yeah. I don't know what happened to the epi. There's definitely going to be a fight though. Phases Void leaps in. Can go for the double chrono. Actually only caught... Only one here was the Phoenix. Also locking in his other teammate, the Skywrath Mage. Ends up being a one-for-one trade-off. Just, yeah. Did you see what attacked the SK, or...
I don't think he got attacked. I think So what happened is the Jug scouted the sniper randomly just assassinating the Storm over the trees, and... what probably happened is Storm saw the debuff for the assassinate. It was like, what the heck is going on here? Why am I getting assassinated? It just rolls back, and then after that, SK no longer has a target, so it kind of blinks out ineffectually and doesn't really find anything. Because it would have taken a max range blink into a burrow, I think, for him to be able to connect there. So yeah, it was just the fact that they threw in the assassinate a little bit too early kind of gave the gank away.
Well, that means Epi gets to go back on a cooldown again, but it's not a long time for a cooldown. It's a long time for Roshan, almost 2.5 out of 3 minutes they have to wait for him to spawn up. But this gives time for Invasion now to force out the bottom lane. So they attack into the tier 1 tower. Faces Void with no chrono, doesn't really want to become part of this fight. Mods could still do a hell of a lot of control. He does have a Ghost Hit, so he can protect himself from the Juggernaut Omni Slash, which is 12 seconds off cooldown. The MVP just let him have the bottom tower. Letting Q-O farm up on the top lane. And they'll defend if Invasion try and push any further than this.
Yeah, they just want their chrono back, and it's only 10 seconds away, so... I think that's really what they're waiting for here. They're also... Both teams are starting to get a little bit antsy about Roshan. You can see that there's some flares going in and some scouting. Because they're both keeping track of the time and realizing, okay, look, it's only about a minute to go. If we lose a team fight now, odds are that team can go straight into Roshan and clean it up, and that's going to be a huge advantage. So that's why both teams are kind of hovering around here right now. They're probably even going to check one more time.
Void, he's considering applying Leap Up, and he gets him. He found the Juggernaut. And the skull, there will be the Mystic Flare. They'll find enough damage to get the kill, and there's that blink in. They had the Epicenter, but he could have gone over towards the Witch Doctor, used the Yorsep, the nice hook shot in. That'll cancel the TP, getting two hero pickoffs. But it was the blink in using the Yule Scepter to cancel the Death Ward, and then trying to bring that Epicenter over to kill the Juggernaut, but the damage was already done. So the two heroes down, MVP, going for the easiest Roshan ever. They don't even need everyone there, that's why Aces goes to the bottom lane.
They're pinging at the... They're like, what? How did he find me there? We have a D Ward over here. Surely there must be a ward in this area.
There was nothing.
But there was nothing. Yeah,
the only ward they had was this one on the cliffside. And the vision from that does actually come down this line, which is where he saw him. But they didn't see anything on the other side of the tree line. Storm Spirit, TP out. He's under the protection of BKB. But you've just used your 10-second BKB to protect yourself. It's not really the first way you want to use a BKB as a Storm Spirit. But at least he doesn't die. Upside.
Yeah, unfortunately for him, the Epi and the Chrono are both still on cooldown, so it's not going to be a window of opportunity for MVP, having seen the fact that ended up being used. And they've got a couple of items to wait around and farm for anyway before they try and go and really make full use of this Aegis. It's such a shame for Storm. I think this draft just played out a little bit awkwardly for Invasion. They really wanted to pick the Storm because they saw the sniper and the clockwork had already been taken, but this is what happens when you take Storms so early in the draft. You play against Skywrath and Sand King and Void, and it just makes your life so difficult. He's been able to get very few pickoffs this game because he always has to be worried about, is one of those three heroes sitting behind my target, and it being more than 50% of the MVP lineup just means that you can hardly ever go for safe picks, because it's very unlikely that you're going to see all three of those heroes on the map at once.
Kiro is having the time of his life right now as this sniper. He was playing around with the Witch Doctor before, and then you realize that level 3 assassination can take off almost 3/4 the life points of the Witch Doctor with just one hit. I don't think you're even going to get to a point now where you have to worry about the Yulz disabling him when he goes to the Death Ward. You just attack him twice as a sniper, and he'll die.
Yeah.
The poor guy. And Sniper does have enough money now, and the courier's flying out. That's the full Scardy done. Yep, there it is. Picked up on the courier, flying down south. So this makes it even harder for the Juggernaut to try and keep up with everyone. It's going to get slowed up. You got a whole lot of stats now to get through as well on the Sniper. So he moves up from 1500 to just over 2k, almost shy of 2.1k life points. And with the 14 armor up his sleeve too,
Radiant's bottom tower.
Your only hope is catching him with his Mask of Madness on. And no one else of his team being nearby him. Oops! Falcorino on top. Faces Void realized it the second he used it as well. But that was not the place to use it. Are they gonna still try and fight this? Well, there's no Chrono. Icarus dive away, Phoenix leaping himself forward, extinct. Sitting in the tree line, so he's ready to blink himself in and just go for a Phoenix. Well, Faces Void was expecting a turnaround there as he triggered his BKB, but he'll go down. While in middle lane, you need that Sky Wrath Mage to get the silence, but the hook shot, yep, off target. He had to angle up higher, or else he would have just bumped into the creep wave there.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
So it was more hope that ADTR would hide close to the tree line. But he didn't.
And WTF has realized that Storm might not be able to get into these fights as well as he would like, so he has purchased a Blink Dagger for himself. But it also makes him a split-pushing menace, honestly. With the Manta style and the blink, so it looks like he's going to be putting down as much pressure as he can. Though there is some catch for him to be worried about, and
like the smoke one coming to bottom lane, epicenter, preps, blink forward, and they got him. Oh, they got him so bad. Juggernaut just drops like a sack of potatoes down the stairs, and they might even go for more. Nope, the TP of the Storm Spirit goes out in time. But you've got top lane just being pushed out by Faceless Void. He just doesn't care. With the Juggernaut down, the kill potential up against him just doesn't exist anymore. And Kiro will take the tier 2 tower, forcing players to come back. Chrono's up. Leap. Chrono found the Witch Doctor. I feel that's a little bit of overkill. But at the same time, they bring down the Phoenix as well in the mid lane. With a three hero advantage now in the way of MVP, they can just go up to the high ground. They may not get the whole thing, but they can at least take the tier 3. Tower has wow, Ace. I think MVP are feeling invincible right now, Basekip. Just the move of the SK just flags that.
He's just doing whatever he feels like at the moment, I think.
Well, nothing's gonna stop him. With an Aghanim set to Faceless Void, you're gonna have your Chrono back. They bring down the tower. In comes the Storm Spirit. And where's your protection? Sniper dead very, very quickly. The BKB from the Storm Spirit is doing its work. Chrono is 5 seconds away. And my nuts. The other nuts. Into the tree line. Ghost Scepter protects him. Now turns. There's your Chrono. Well, is it? Yep, there it is. Gonna go on the Storm Spirit while they isolated the march. So he can't do isolates the rest of the invasion lineup, so he can't do anything. The Juggernaut will still chase down the Faceless Void with a Diffuser Blade, making it difficult for Void just to leap himself away. Triggers the BKB, the Sand King can't bar a strike away in time, so he'll drop the gem, and MVP are losing the team fight. They're about to lose the Faceless Void in the trees, and they do so. Was that 4 for the price of 1 or 2? The buyback came out from Phoenix, so it was 2.
Okay, that was a little bit of 3-2-2 right there, I think, from MVP. Like, wow, it's 23-8. We're crushing this game so hard. High ground time, boys. And Sand King's just doing whatever, and then
in that fight, man,
invasion comes charging in.
Juggernaut got 2.6k gold and 3.5k experience from just Dire's that fight. Because he got the solo kill on the void. So he just soaked everything up.
That's huge. He just bought his Diffusal Blade before and he's already got 3.2k. That's a lot of money.
Goes to get chipped back a little bit. But as MVP hasn't thrown this game completely.
Nah.
But they've given one hell of a hope over to Invasion to bring it back. Like, there's a 15k advantage in gold and roughly an 18k advantage in experience for MVP.
You won't be seeing me.
They lost maybe 20-30% of that. So it wasn't as critical, and they've still got their ulti combos. Like, you still got Nagatim's Void. The Clockwork is very close to finishing up his own ags. And that Scythe is on the way for the Sand King. So I'm not feeling any major problems still for MVP when it comes to team fights. Unless they do another one like the last time. Then they're screwed.
If they lose another fight, Jug can buy, I guess, an Abyssal Blade, and at that point, he can just jump Sniper every fight and kill him.
Well, he's gonna find Sniper. The Invis Rune's there, but remember, well, the gem was taken back, or taken over by Invasion. They jump in. WTF reveals himself, Chrono, well off target. He just tries to go for the Feast, who comes in and drops a Nova down. WTF, nice epicenter. Able to find that extra damage that MVP were really searching for, while Storm Spirit just locked for the moment, but the cogs working against the rest of MVP, but with Sniper, with a Blink Dagger, he just sits on the high ground playing King of the Hill. Extinct in, big Echo Slam, at least finds one. He's going to lose his own life points. Sealed up, they blink back down again. And it's a double kill for the Faceless Void. They really needed to keep the control over on the Sniper, and they just didn't find it. What a time for a Blink Dagger purchase from QO. He's making a beeline for the bottom lane too. Big fight from MVP.
I just couldn't finish the Sniper attack. They spent the entire fight chasing around in circles and still managed to survive. So. Nicely played there by QO, and this is looking like it should probably be... Yeah, it should probably be two lanes of racks and... More than likely the game. Invasion probably still gonna try and take Radiant's one more fight here if they can. They still got good catch, still got some pretty good team fight, and I think, yeah, Jug still has the Omni Slash available.
Well, they know that MVP, if they're gonna GG, they just have to take out the tier 4 towers. Attack. MVP, all they really want. Whoop! Hello, long jump. QO needs more protection, can't get out of there. The Omni, well, this time don't screw up your ultimate. He got a Chrono! He got the Juggernaut! It's just on the tip of the Chrono, but it's not enough to find the kill, so Juggernaut drops the healing wall to try and come back into this fight. The Fissure gonna be a little bit off target. The Skywraith Mage is gonna get mopped up. Ghost Scepter will make him work a little bit harder, but that's why he also bought the Fusil Blade, so we can get rid of that one. As the rest of MVP just bail the hell out of there, especially the Faceless Void. They didn't take out the melee racks on bottom. The catapults didn't finish the job. I'd also be very careful if I was Invasion right now. He says Epicenter coming back off cooldown. If they tried to overcommit into the mid, they could find themselves losing any advantage they thought they had. Especially now also with the Scythe of Vice over on the SK.
Yeah, this is dangerous. MVP are honestly just getting sloppy, I think. And well played by Invasion to be taking advantage of it, and WTF seeing the opportunity to commit a buyback there and get something out of it, but... There is actually Roshan up as well. This is a pretty big... unfortunately, Invasion get nothing out of this, and they're not even going to be able to scout Rosh, so it looks like maybe Aegis and Cheese going to end up in the hands of MVP. Almost Refresher Orb as well for the Faceless Void.
With a double Chrono, it hasn't been sloppy is the best word for the Chrono as well from the Faceless Void. Very few heroes caught inside the Chronosphere in the previous time. And, like, you saw him battling up against the Juggernaut. The Juggernaut's ulti just lasted so long, he didn't know when he was meant to Chrono, if he was actually going to catch him out. And if he Chronoed, like, maybe he would have caught out two or three heroes, but he thought he might also be dying to that Omni Slash. So he wanted to try and, like, pass it off to one of his teammates since he backed up. Just a little bit of panic, I think, coming out from MVP when it comes to these fights.
Fallen to the Dire.
Right, so Aegis the Maul into the Sniper, we got Cheese on the Faceless Void, and MVP have an exposed Rax on bottom. An Invasion, they just smoked on top of the Dire Observer Ward. Expect a trap here from MVP. The best place to set the trap is probably going to be this box right here. Put the sniper into the tree line back here, and you go for the chrono spot. But they need vision. They need vision here. And QO, what are you doing? He walks into it. Now Void looks for the big chrono, and he's caught four of them. Where's your epithet? He can't just reach him because they went so deep here. But it's just going to be QO picking up the double kill. But sniper, it's all his. Now the Omni Slash. They want to split it up, and they're going to do so. Wait, Radiance, he blinks away at the very end of the trees. I think he's blocked himself off with his own healing ward. Dyer's that gets killed off. Wait, you have an observer ward. Okay, they don't care. Let Juggernaut stay. Hey, is he trapped? He's locked in the trees. Oh, he's got the blink off cooldown now, but still. Dyer's MVP now approach the bottom lane. No Phoenix, no Witch Doctor. Phoenix will, she does have buyback. The Echo Slam comes in, but a very quick follow-up from the Seal. March will lock him inside the cogs. And I think Storm Spirit, yeah, with a double Burrow Strike as well. WTF was even getting controlled. The blink back by QO keeps a bit, keeps the distance up. The heal step the timing from the SK. I don't think that was really helping out the clockwork with the hookshot up against ADTR. But the refresher orb is, wait, completely done flying out the courier. Not necessarily going to help the Void right now, because they've kind of already won the game. Storm, long jump in. Dire Strike won't have any effect. BKB protects him, faces Void, in for the death ward. He triggers the cheese. FCFC's backing up, but QO. Oh, the Chrono caught him as well. So he's currently locked his own teammate's Chrono, but it's over. Secondary Chrono in the assassination. And MVP will take the series 2-0. Invasion, not the greatest start to the day, but they do have a chance to come back. They're up against Bineski next. But that really, yeah. That could have been over about 15, 20 minutes ago, I think, Basekip.
Yeah, I think MVP not the cleanest ending to the match, but they played the early and the mid game so excellently that I think you can forgive them a little bit. Unfortunately, Ghost gonna end up with negative fantasy points. I think the Phoenix was a response to the Faceless Void, but I don't know. I think Invasion weren't looking past the Void, and you know, as we both said, there was already the Skywrath Mage on the table, which made life very, very hard. So,
if you're looking at the raw team fight, then MVP Phoenix had a lot working for them, but yeah, you can't just plan for the team fight. You got to plan for the laning stage, and that's where things fell apart. I think for MVP, especially that Phoenix offlane, it just didn't work. And the Juggernaut, like, you knew he was going to get controlled by the Void.
Yeah. And Ace, what a Sand King game. That was really, really well done. I think the shining star of MVP that game, for sure.
Agreed. Maybe he'll become part of their new solid roster. Either way, MVP should be very happy with their result. While now it opens up the Pro League for Southeast Asia, Invasion. They were sitting at 7-1, now they're 7-3, so they're drawn up with Signature Trust. And we do see MVP Phoenix moving up. They are 6-2. So they're nibbling at the heels. In fact, they're sitting next to Rave in the best position to qualify up for Southeast Asia. It's a very, very close fight. For all the details, go to joiner.com, use the navigation bar, click on leagues, and you'll find all the information. We need to go to a short break, as our next game is already awaiting for us. Invasion will get themselves back into the lobby, and they're up against Bineski in just a moment.